Jessica, thank you. Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Any of you ever just have one of those mornings? You know what I mean. One of those. Yeah, okay, that's might be a better question. Any of you ever not have one of those mornings? Sometimes they maybe feel like they're a little more frequent than others. This morning is one of those mornings, right? Getting out of the house this morning took a little bit longer than wanted. Got here a little bit later than planned. One of the songs we're doing is just phenomenal, but like chord movement wise for the band is quite different than what we normally do, and so that can be frustrating. We've got a busy service.
I raised my hand.
Okay. Busy service. We've got shoeboxes today. We've got installation of elders and deacons. Some liturgy may or may not have been left at home and had to be printed really quickly. Like, just, you know, all the things. All the things. and it's like, oh, there must be something really good happening here today. Amen?
Yeah.
And the reason why it feels a little scattered is because we've got an enemy who's against us and says, oh, I hate that you're gathering in the name of Jesus today. But that's who we are here to worship today. And so I'm excited to see what God has in store for us, for his people today. And we've been praying for you. We've been praying for this service today. And so, man, I hope you're as excited as I am. Would you please stand with us and let us first hear from Psalm 95. This version might sound just a little bit different than what you're used to, but I absolutely love this psalm. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout out praises to our protector who delivers us. Let us enter his presence with thanksgiving. Let us shout out to him in celebration. For the Lord is a great God, a great King who is superior to all gods. The depths of the earth are in his hand. The mountain peaks, they belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it. His hands formed the dry land. Come, let us bow down and worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Creator, for he is our God. We are the people of his pasture, the sheep he owns. Amen. Amen. Let us sing this awesome song, Turning Graves into Gardens.
And fill me.
Amen. Well, again, good morning. We are so glad you're here worshiping with us. Maybe you had one of those mornings like we did. But our Heavenly Father, our Savior, Lord Jesus Christ says, come and bring your burdens to me, and I will give you rest. So give your burden to the Lord today and find that peace, find that rest that can only come through the Good Shepherd, Jesus Christ. Again, good morning. We invite you to have a seat, and we'll invite John to come on up from the back as he's quickly looking in that bulletin and saying, what is going on in this church? And he's about to inform us all in case you haven't taken a gander at that thing yet.
Thank you, Stephen. Good morning. Welcome to Mattawan Community Church. It's good to see everybody this morning. There are a few announcements I would like to bring to your attention. First off, tomorrow, November 13th at 6:30, there is a council meeting. So calling all council members currently on council, calling all new council members. And then Monday, tomorrow also, November 13th through 20th, is the Operation Christmas Child Shoebox Collection Week. So as you did see when you came in, I guess I should say, some of the shoeboxes that are in there that people have brought in today for dedication day. If you neglected or forgot, maybe I shouldn't use the word neglected. I keep correcting myself here. If you forgot to bring in your shoebox, you still have time. Or you know what? Even if you forgot to do one, you wanted to do one, and you didn't take one home, you can still do that. You can still bring those in this week. And there is a schedule for that. I'm not exactly sure what that is. It's not like it's 6 to 6. It's not something like that. I believe it's from 10 to 12. Pretty much every single day, possibly. Okay. Maybe send an email to the church email to share it if you would like to confirm on that. And then Wednesday, November 15th, we have WOW. We will meet together at 6 o'clock for fellowship and food and go to classes at 6:30. And then there's another thing on here, November special events that you may be interested in. Take a look at that. It's called Painting Plates of Plenty if you would like to participate in that. Another thing I wanted to mention too, we've got more catalogs back there. This is not the only one, so if you would like to take one of these home with you, just make sure that it's turned in before, what was that, December 10th? December 10th, make sure that's turned in before December 10th. I believe there's like five or so of those back there. I will put this one back. And then another thing I do want to mention that's in our bulletin, this also ties in obviously to opening up the Word every day, but prayer, look at the prayer request, go over that, but also pray fervently for the things that are going on within the body of this church, or the body of the church in the entire United States and the world. That's not on here. There's a lot going on. We got a lot going on in our lives. That's not on here. So I did not bring up a daily bread with me. And I didn't even bring my phone with me to say, hey, a YouVersion plug. But I did bring up my Bible, the Word of God. And that's what all of those encouragement have been about, is trying to get involved in those, finding something, some kind of purposeful thing that you enjoy that ties into opening up the Word daily. Whether you have your physical Bible copy, pretty much everybody has a smartphone. So another plug for the YouVersion Bible app. That thing is awesome. There are so many things in there, as I want to continue to encourage you guys. Again, before you know it, it's going to be December, and before you know it's going to be the beginning of the year. Start doing that if you haven't done that already. Start getting into the Word daily. As we continue in our service, I would like to ask anyone who is willing and able to stand up and greet your neighbor with some of that MCC cheer.
Well, our next song this morning is a wonderful confession of our faith. It's titled Christ Our Hope in Life and Death. We've sung it a few times, but I really want to just read through this. And just, I invite you to close your eyes and listen to the words of this song. What is our hope in life and death? Christ alone, Christ alone. What is our only confidence? That our souls to him belong. Who holds our days within his hands, and what comes apart from his command? What will keep us to the end? The love of Christ in which we stand. Oh, sing hallelujah. Our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah. Now and ever we confess Christ, our hope in life and death. What truth can calm the troubled soul? Well, God is good. God is good. Where is his grace and goodness known? In our great Redeemer's blood. Who holds our faith when fears arise? Who stands above the stormy trial? Who sends the waves that bring us nigh unto the shore, the rock of Christ? Unto the grave, what shall we sing? Christ, he lives. Christ, he lives. And what reward will heaven bring? Everlasting life with him. There we will rise to meet the Lord. Then sin and death will be destroyed. And we will feast in endless joy when Christ is ours forevermore. Oh, sing hallelujah. Our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah. Now and ever we confess Christ, our hope in life and death.
Rise to meet the Lord. It's in and out.
us pray. What is our only hope in life and death? It is Christ alone, Christ alone. Father God, we thank you and we praise you for your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, our Lord. We praise you because we need not fear what comes our way here on earth. For who holds the gates of hell, the keys to death? It is you. It is you. And so when we put our trust and our faith in you, we need not fear. This is good news. It is the good news. The gospel message that it is through you alone, Jesus, that salvation is found. Oh, Lord, we have confessed that this morning has been just one of those mornings. A lot going on. Busyness. And Satan hates the fact that we are gathering in your name. But praise be to you, Father, that through your Son, through the powerful name of Jesus, we can pray these things and Satan must flee. He's out of here. For we have gathered in the name of our Savior Jesus Christ today. And so, Lord, all that distraction stuff that came before the service, all of the stress that came with this song, trying to play it right, the stress that comes with forgetting something at home, the distraction that comes with us maybe leaving our shoebox at home, the distraction of a wayward child, the distraction of our 401k and how it's been doing, the distraction of politics, an unrest in Israel and the Ukraine. All that stuff, Father, it's easy for us to be distracted. It's easy for us to focus on just the little thing that's right in front of us, forgetting that you are the one who conquered death. You're the one that holds all things. And nothing happens without your knowledge of it. And so, Father, if that's been us the last few days, getting caught up in it all, may we rest in the sovereignty of you today. May we bring the burdens that we easily so many times put upon ourselves. Oh, we think somebody else put it on us, but ultimately we're the one that really grabbed the burden and put it on us. May we take the burden off. May we lay it at the foot of the cross. May we focus on you today. May we focus on the good news that it might seem like the battle is being lost, but you've already won the war. May we rest in the security that comes in the salvation found only in you. Oh, Holy Spirit, we praise you and we thank you for the gift of your guidance and your comfort. And we ask that you would guide us today in the busyness of this service, that all things that are done would be done to your glory. We pray way ahead of where all these shoeboxes are going. You know where everyone is going, and the name of every child who's going to receive it. You know their birth date. You know the number of hairs on their head. You know their personal situation. And so we pray ahead of it that you would prepare their hearts for the good news message that comes when they open a box. And Father, we lift our pastor to you today and the stress that he has felt this morning, that would be put aside, that you would envelop him and use him and speak through him today. As your people, Father, we are eager to hear from you today. We take comfort in the passage we read at the beginning, that we are the sheep owned by you, the good shepherd. And so we rest in the pen today, among other sheep, looking to you, our good shepherd, to guide us, to lead us, to instruct us, to comfort us. And wherever we are with our walk with you today, we ask that you meet us exactly where we're at, and you strengthen our relationship with you. It's in the powerful, awesome, holy name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, we pray these things. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Oh, the way the morning's gone. Stephen mentioned it in his prayer, mentioned it as we were getting together. I'm reminded of a sentence, a statement that I heard on the television here a few months back when SpaceX took off and it exploded. I don't know if you remember that. It's probably about 8 months or so ago, and I wrote it down because I thought someday that's going to come in handy. This morning it came in handy. What we have experienced is an unscheduled disassembly. I just got to get, instead of saying the thing blew up, you know, oh no, it was an unscheduled disassembly. So we had a little bit of an unscheduled disassembly this morning, but we're assembling things back together. And we're going to have a great worship service today. Why? Because this is the day the Lord has made, and we will rejoice, and we will be glad in it. It is good that we've come together in this place at this time to lift the name of Jesus Christ above every name in heaven and on earth. One of the responsibilities that we have in our church is the installation of elders and deacons and having a functioning council. So we're going to install a couple of elders and a couple of deacons this morning. Before we do that, though, I want to recognize those deacons and elders who are coming off at this time. I see Al Goodrich is not here, but we definitely appreciate all the work that Al has done for the last 2 years as deacon. Dan Moyle is back there somewhere. One of you want to kind of bring him in. Let's see. Then on our elder side, Christine Ruger has been an elder for the last couple of years, and Sherida. Sherida is with her folks, I believe, this weekend. It's her turn to help take care of them. But because Sherida isn't here, I'll pick on Mike and have him come up because I've got just some recognition and some gifts up here. So, Christine, if you'd come on up and someone go back and find Dan. He's got a baby in his arms, I think. And when he's got a baby, it's hard to track him down. But if you just come up here and face the congregation, and where did Mike go? Mike Janicki, would you come on up and represent your wife, please? I know she's with Mom and Dad today with their situation. But so Mike is standing here with Sherida. Sherida is also our church secretary, and these folks have done an awful lot of work for us, so there's a thank you coffee mug in here and another gift. I've given out mugs over 20 years, so you guys should have a whole shelf full of coffee mugs. And there you go. And congregation, let's give these folks a round of applause for all their work. Thank you very much. I also want to recognize Tim and Julie and Steve Ruger. They are willing to continue on. And I almost feel a little sheepish that I'm not giving them coffee mugs too, because you shouldn't have to come off of, off of your position in order to receive a gift. But I do have a gift for you folks anyway, so just a little something. Not another coffee mug, so. But thank you all very much. Well, this morning we are going to install our new council. Again, Steve Ruger will continue as our treasurer. Tim and Julie will continue as financial secretaries. We are installing two elders and two deacons. Beloved in the Lord, we come to install elders and deacons in Christ's holy church. Christ alone is the source of all Christian ministry through the ages, calling men and women to serve. By the Holy Spirit, all who believe and are baptized receive a ministry to witness to Jesus as Savior and Lord, and to love and serve those with whom they live and work. We are ambassadors for Christ, who reconciles and makes whole. We are the salt of the earth, the light of the world. Following Christ's resurrection and ascension, God has given the church apostles, prophets, teachers, deeds of power, gifts of healing, and forms of assistance and leadership. We stand in a tradition where God calls and empowers deacons and elders and ministers of word and sacrament. This congregation has elected the following people as office into the offices of deacon and elder. So today we will install Mary Molnar and Pete Slager to the office of deacon, Jeff Myers and John Moyer to the office of elder. In just a moment, I will have you four please come forward. Let me say these few words first. Deacons and elders are called to serve Christ and to serve the church. We look to them to be people of spiritual commitment, exemplary life, compassionate spirit, and sound judgment. Deacons are set apart for a ministry of mercy and service and outreach. They gather the gifts and the offerings, and they care for them faithfully and distribute them with wisdom and compassion to persons in need and for the purpose to advance God's kingdom here on earth. Deacons visit and comfort the distressed, provide for whatever necessities may arise, and assist the congregation in the service of worship. Elders are set apart for a ministry of watchful and responsible care for the welfare and the order of the church. They have oversight of all members, including one another, the deacons, and even the minister, equipping everyone to live in harmony with God's word. They ensure the word of God is rightly proclaimed and taught, and the sacraments are faithfully administered. Elders assist the minister with their good counsel and serve all Christians with advice, consolation, and encouragement. Elders and deacons, together with the minister, form our council to lead God's people in proclaiming the good news to the poor, righteousness to the nations, peace among all people. The council provides for the welfare of the church, stewardship of the property and finance, and the spiritual benefit and growth of all Christ's people. As these three offices of deacon, elder, and minister of word and sacrament are united in Christ, so also the church. One office is not separate from the others. The minister of word and sacrament does not serve without the elders or deacons. Neither do they serve without one another. Together, we enable the whole mission of the church. Everything in the church will be done decently and in order with faithful persons called to office and who will responsibly fulfill the charge. At this time, I invite our newly elected deacons and elders to come forward. Mary and Pete, Jeff and John, would you come and face the congregation this morning? All right, brothers and sister in Christ, I ask that you will answer these questions sincerely before the congregation. Do you confess together with us and through the church throughout the ages your faith in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? Do you believe in your heart that you are called by Christ's church and therefore by God to this office? Do you believe the books of the Old and New Testament to be the Word of God and the perfect doctrine of salvation, rejecting all contrary beliefs? Will you be diligent in your study of the Holy Scripture and in the use of your means of grace? Will you pray for God's people and lead them by your own example in faithful service and holy living? Will you accept the church's order and governance, submitting to the ecclesiastical discipline should you become delinquent in either life or doctrine? Will you be loyal to the witness and work of the Conservative Congregational Conference, using your abilities to further Christ's mission here and throughout the world? Deacons, will you faithfully and diligently and cheerfully manifest God's love and care? Will you gather and distribute the offerings of God's people, visit and comfort the distressed, minister to the poor and needy, and strive to advance God's reign of justice and peace? Elders, will you faithfully, diligently, and cheerfully study God's word, oversee the household of faith, encourage spiritual growth, maintain loving discipline, and provide for the proclamation of the gospel and the celebration of the sacraments? Amen. At this time, I would ask the congregation to arise at this time and affirm your covenant with these people, your elders and deacons. members, attendees of Mattawan Community Church, do you receive in the name of the Lord these deacons and elders as duly elected and ordained servants of Christ?
We do.
Do you promise to respect them for the sake of the offices for which they have been chosen and ordained? Do you promise to encourage and pray for them, to labor together in obedience to the gospel for the unity, purity, and peace of the church, the welfare of the whole world, and to honor our Lord Jesus Christ?
Yes.
My dear friends, receive these deacons and elders as Christ's own servant. Support them in love, and their work may bear fruit. In the name and by the authority of our Lord Jesus Christ, I declare these brothers and sister duly installed as elders in this church. Let us pray. O gracious God, we ask that your grace will rest upon these elders and deacons, not those just standing before us, but in those who are already installed and who have been serving for some time. We ask that you will keep them strong and faithful, that your church may prosper in peace. I ask that you will grant them wisdom, courage, discretion, and benevolence, that they may fulfill their charge to the glory of Jesus Christ. Bestow your grace on these people that we may support these deacons and elders with prayer, cooperation, and encouragement to guard them from growing weary in doing what is right. And we ask that you will inspire your whole church with your spirit of power, unity, and peace. Grant that all who trust you may live together in love. All this we pray in the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. You may be seated. Mary, congratulations. Pete, welcome. John, Jeff, thank you so much for your willingness to serve. One half of your new council. I think we have council meeting tomorrow night. Welcome aboard. All right. Well, there's stuff going on in this church concerning missions, and I believe Barb Moyle is going to come up and tell us all about what's going on this month with our missions. Come on up, Barb.
So I just want to thank all of you for being here and witnessing what's going on in this church. I'm going to have all those little people coming in a few minutes and bringing those boxes in that are going to go around the world. And that's such a blessing from our small church, contributing the amount of boxes we do. But the funniest part about those little boxes this year is they'll have those little tracking numbers on them, so you can scan your little thing, and if you got one, and watch your box go everywhere it travels to before it gets to the destination of that child. And I'm really not even here to tell you about that, but it's this month is we are actually doing for the Christmas distribution for the Mattawan Pantry. For those of you who don't know, the Mattawan Area Pantry used to be right out here in our garage until it became so large that they made it a part of the new renovation down at school. And in those days, we were serving about 75 families. Well, Tim tells me this last month or so, they're serving 115 families. I am the mission person for November, which are gifts, and we've chosen many years ago, well, probably five now, instead of trying to find some kind of a little something for each one of those child, we decided to do socks. Socks are what we do for November now for the mission of the pantry on December 16th, and it's held at the Antrim Township Hall. Many of the community people come out. The Lions Club do the toys with the Toys for Tots, and in the next little row of, in the building there, we do our mission outreach for socks. And then we also choose for December hats and mittens. We've done hats and mittens for 35 years for the community. Socks are a new thing. They're about 5 years, and we decided that was going to work. They love the socks. Well, previous last year, I looked over the thing, and I said, oh, my goodness, we did socks for 420 kids last year. And last year, we were doing about 75 families a month, sometimes a little more. Well, now there's 115 families a month, and they've already got a sign-up with yet a month to go of 181 families. I don't have any idea how many kids are going to come, but B&G and I have come to know each other very well. I walk in the door last week, and he's so generous, and Eric said, what are you after today? And I said, I thought I was done. buying hats and mittens and socks, but I have to have more. So I filled another cart with $160 worth of hats and mittens that he gave us 40 cents each. Hmm. Yeah. So I've spent a lot of money there, but I'm reaching out because of it and a little on the edgy side, because if we had 420 kids last year, and so I upped my buying 20% for both socks, hats, and mittens. And while this congregation, you cannot even know how generous you are, those boxes are going around the world. This little mission team that we have is such a blessing to my heart, because we choose each one. We do the gospel mission. We do the wings of God. We do alternatives. We do cure for a world mission. We have the outreach that is so astounding that many don't even realize what we've done each month. But it is phenomenal, your outreach. And I know that this year, each and every one of those people that come have, I was on the Mattawam Area Pantry Board for many, many, many years. I did retire from that, but it's amazing when we walk in there and they look, hi, you guys. They know us, and we have an outreach that is unspoken. This church has been in this community over 100 years. We are here, and the devil is working very hard to rip us apart. I sat at lunch, was that lunch or breakfast, with the ladies last week, with all this prayer list. And I said, but isn't it reassuring that we have a church family to lean on? You are the ones that keep this together. And I only have one more tiny little word to say, and it's near to me. Please keep our military in your prayers. Veterans Day this week, I have a grandson serving in the military, Marines. This country's in a shambles right now. I'm so disappointed by that country. I can't even tell you about it. Keep our veterans and our military in your prayers as well. There's a lot of military right here. Soldiers for God.
Thank you, Barb. Well, that's awesome about B&G. That stands for Bible and God, doesn't it? Yeah, if you've never been there, that is just one great big huge garage sale that changes weekly, but every day, yeah, new merchandise all the time. That's awesome that the family would give us such a great discount. Yeah. Well, Deb Carlin, is she around somewhere? She's got her children's message today. Excellent. I'd like to invite all the children to come forward, boys and girls. This is a special day. We're going to ask you to help out here in a little while. Oh, there you are, Deb. I'm looking back there. Sorry. Come on up. We've got a lot of work to do this morning, so come on up, because we're going to need a little bit of help today.
Good morning. How is everyone today?
Good.
Glad to hear it. Well, this is a very special day, isn't it? We've got shoeboxes going on. We're doing lots of fun things. And I know that I did this once before with you guys, but I thought it would be really fitting to do it again because it's all about giving. And Jesus told us that when we do for the least of these, the least of people, of children, that we're doing for him. So when we show love to little people across the world that we don't know, or big people across the street that we don't really know very well, when we show them love, we're showing Jesus love. We're doing his work here on earth. And that's what he wants us to do. And I don't know why it seems so hard to do that sometimes, because it's really quite easy. Instead of being cranky, be kind. Instead of getting upset by that person on the road that made us mad, Just let it go. Look at the day. The gifts that God has given us. They're amazing. And so we have to readjust, don't we? Well, so I wanted to show you this one more time. Because God has said that what we do, he will bless. Do you remember this one? How many corners are on this sheet of paper? Four. Okay. But if I tear this corner off and I give it to you, how many corners do you have?
Three.
Now, how many corners do I have? One, two, three, four, five. I have one more than I did before. And Noah has three. Now, if I give another one away to you, how many corners do you have? Three. That's six corners altogether there. And how many corners do I have here? One, two, three, four, five, six. I had five, now I have six. When I give my blessings away, I get more blessings. And when I give my blessing away, you have more than just one blessing, don't you? Isn't that amazing? God says, don't hang on to those things that we love so much, money, friends, family. Share it. Share it all. And you will have more and more. So much more, you won't know what to do with it other than to give it back to God. And when God gives you things, we share them. I'm going to read to you. It says, here in Luke 6, do not judge, and you will not be judged. Do not condemn, and you will not be condemned. Forgive, and you will be forgiven. Give, and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. More corners, more blessings than you can count. For with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. The fruits of the Spirit are, do you guys remember the fruits of the Spirit? Let's say them. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. So, as God gives you love and brings you joy, or any of those others, patience, peace, he wants us to give everyone else the same. Not crankiness, not anger. Peace, patience, joy. And he will make your cup run over. I have one other demonstration I want to show you because this came up while I was looking up and studying my message. There's another spot in the Bible. It's from Matthew 6. And there's a whole passage about not worrying. Jesus tells us, don't worry about your life or what you will eat or drink or about your body. It says, don't worry about your clothes. Don't worry about what you eat. It says, seek first the kingdom of God. And then all that other stuff will come to you. Seeking first the kingdom of God. When we don't give him 100% like this beautiful apple. It's kind of like we're giving him this apple. Where does this apple usually end up? In the garbage or on the ground, forgotten, unwanted. Do you want to think of yourself as giving God garbage? No, I don't either. Some days we just don't seek him first. Jesus will take our garbage. God will take our garbage. But he really wants our best. He loves us no matter what. But he asks us to do our best. Seek him first in your giving, in your living, in your receiving. And he will give you so much more. And he will give you the fruits of the Spirit. Let's say thank you. Dear God, as we bring our gifts, we ask that you would bless them. We know that you have promised that with these small gifts that we are giving to children we don't know in our Christmas boxes, you have promised that they will be blessed so much more than we can know. And so we ask, dear God, fill those boxes with your love so those children know you and feel you and can live with you so that they will know your love too forever and ever. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Thank you, kids.
All right.
Boys and girls, I encourage you to go to the back. We are going to start to collect our boxes and bring them forward. If anyone brought a Christmas shoe box, you have it with you. If you just raise your hand, one of the children will bring them forward. Otherwise, we're going to bring them all up, and then I'll ask all the children to come forward, and we're going to lay our hands on them, and we will send them off together. Stephen, do we have music while this goes on? Awesome. If not, I was going to put Jessica on the spot, but that's all right. Don't be shy. Grab some boxes and bring them on up, boys and girls.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare in room. And heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing.
61, way to go, sisters. 94, 95, 96, 97, 98, 99. Who's going to be our 100th? Esther, you are 100. Our 100th box, sister, right behind, 101. 101 boxes. Wow, that's awesome. Come on up. So the first 100 boxes the church will pay for, so I feel sorry for the one person that has to pay the fee to send their box overseas. Oh, thank you so much. You know, we're going to kneel down on one knee. We're going to put our hands on the box like this. Okay, did you know the disciples, the apostles did this to one another when they sent them out in the mission field? Come on in, Jennifer. Is there room for you? Brighton, scooch next to me a little bit so she can be next to sis here. Atta boy, girl. There you go. We'll put our hand on the box, and we're going to bless these boxes. Let's bow together, and let us pray, okay? Heavenly Father, we thank you so much. We live in a land where we have so much stuff. We just go to the store and pick out things we like and take them home and play with them. We know there are boys and girls around the world that don't have stores in their villages to go and buy toys or maybe a little snack. They just rely on missionaries and other people to come and provide for them. Or they work out in the fields all day long, growing crops. Maybe taking a long walk, a mile or two or three, to bring home a bucket of water from a well. Father, we are truly blessed. We want to pass that blessing on now to other children all around the world. So as our hands are on these boxes, Father, we pray these boxes will have safe passage around the world, wherever they go. Maybe the boys and girls who receive these, open them up. And be pleasantly surprised. May they be blessed. May they be happy. May they be joyful because we gave. Most of all, may they come to know Jesus as we know Jesus as their personal Lord and Savior. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you so much, children. Let's give them a round of applause for all of your hard work. We'll get it. We'll get it. again, let me just reiterate, if you did not bring your box and you've got one planned, bring it to the church anytime this week in the morning, okay? Sherida is packing all of these up with the help of some of you, I know, into our big cartons. That will be going on for the entire week. This church is one of the central churches that other churches are bringing their boxes to, and we are kind of the packing church. So all these will go in cartons. We're going to have some of those cartons up next week so we can see how many boxes have come through our doors from the other churches too. So don't fret if you forgot. You still have this week to bring it by sometime in the morning during the church hours. This morning our scripture lesson comes to us from Acts chapter 2 and from Acts chapter 10. Acts chapter 2 verses 1 through 4. It's on page 1403 for those of you using the chronological Bible that we've been working our way through this year, the Pew Bible on page 856. Let us stand together for the reading of God's holy word. Acts chapter 2, the first four verses. To set the stage, Jesus has died, he has risen, he has ascended into heaven. He promised the disciples the Holy Spirit. They're meeting together in a room. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place, that is, the disciples. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. And then switching over to Acts chapter 10. Verses 44 through 48, page 1417. Acts 10, 44 through 48. While Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit came on all who heard the message. The circumcised believers who had come with Peter were astonished that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out even on Gentiles, for they heard them speaking in tongues and praising God. Then Peter said, "Surely no one can stand in the way of being baptized with water. They have received the Holy Spirit just as we have." So he ordered that they be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Then they asked Peter to stay with them for a few days. This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. Please be seated. He is risen.
He is risen.
Amen. Hang on to that because we're going to find out why I just said that, and it's not Easter. Well, we've been journeying through the Bible, and of course, we are well into the book of Acts at this time. So in the days and week ahead, we're going to find the letters, the epistles, interspersed into the book of Acts, where some people believe they may have been sent at different times during the recorded facts of Acts. My friends, we're just 7 weeks away from completing our journey of reading through the Bible in 1 year. 7 weeks. Hang in there. Hang tough. If you fell behind, I challenge you to get caught up, unless you're clear back in, you know, like Joel or Jonah or something like that, or if you're still back in Exodus, I encourage you just take today's reading and jump right in. But let's hang in there. This has been an awesome, awesome year going through God's Word. Well, this morning I'm going to briefly explain to you the importance of the book of Acts, maybe perhaps more of a lecture than a sermon, but I do have a lesson for us at the end today. It's amazing to me to think that Jesus did not leave his disciples a 10-step plan on how to build a church. If you're going to go into business today, what do? We come up with a goal. What's our goal? We want to sell widgets. Okay, how do we sell widgets? Well, we need to have a factory. We need to design the widget. We need to have employees. We need to buy machinery. So we take all those goals and we separate them into small steps, small goals. Jesus did not do that. He gave the disciples, now called apostles, the Holy Spirit. And the church was born. We see rapid expansion of the church in that very first century. Now, when we look at the book of Acts, as we've moved into Acts, some people will consider Acts as kind of a fifth gospel. Acts is a continuation of the book of Luke. Acts is written by Luke. We know that Luke is a doctor. He's a physician. So Dr. Luke wrote Luke And really, if you read the Gospel of Luke and come to the very last, say read the last chapter and then turn right to Acts and continue on, you see how it all just flows naturally and very well together. One theologian states that Luke was the greatest historian, ancient or modern. Why? Because he covered the most important historical event on earth. The birth, the ministry, the death, the resurrection, the ascension of Christ, and the birth of the church. No other historian has written so much about such an important time for humanity. So Luke gives us an account of the rise of the church, that is, the body of Christ. Now, in the Old Testament, we find that God is introduced to humanity. And the Gospels give us an account of how the God-man, that is, Jesus, came to fulfill the Old Testament covenants, and he established a new covenant. The book of Acts documents the beginning of the new covenant, the narrative of God's redemptive plan. It tells of the church's phenomenal growth in just 3 decades after Jesus had risen from the dead. It's interesting to note that Acts, called in some Bibles and in some circles the Acts of the Apostles, okay, we've simply shortened that version down to just call it the book of Acts, but Acts shows the action of the apostles as the church is birthed. It's interesting to note that the last recorded fact about Jesus in the book of Matthew is the resurrection. This is also recorded in Acts chapter 1. The last recorded fact about Jesus in Mark is the ascension. This also is recorded in Acts chapter 1. The last recorded fact about Jesus in the book of Luke is the promise of the Holy Spirit. And in Acts chapter 1, we read of the Holy Spirit. And the last recorded fact in the Gospel of John is the return of Jesus Christ. And we see the promise again in Acts chapter 1. Acts is truly a great, great book. Here we see a great missionary commission for that was in all 4 Gospels beginning to run throughout the book of Acts. As Genesis records the origin and the birth of our physical universe, so Acts records the origin of the spiritual birth, the body of Christ, what we call the church. It's sort of a bridge between the Gospels and the letters. Now, some people would ask, what exactly is Acts or why the book of Acts? And some people would say, well, it's just simple history. But we know it's more than that. Some would say that Luke is the first apologist. That is, he's the first one to give defense for the church because the church is unfairly accused and treated unfairly. William Barclay says that the book of Acts is to explain the tremendous growth of the church from Jerusalem to Rome in just 3 decades, where over a million people had come to become believers in Jesus Christ. Came across this quote from Chuck Swindoll. I like what he writes. The book of Acts was written to demonstrate from the facts of history that the church has become God's instrument for stewarding the new covenant, that the church is guided by his Spirit, and that nothing can prevent Christ from building his church. It's interesting to note, too, depending on the version of Bible that you read, in some Bibles, the very last word in the book of Acts is unhindered. Unhindered. We find that Paul is under house arrest. He will soon lose his life. He will become a martyr for the gospel. But for 2 years, Paul is under house arrest in Rome. But he's allowed guests. And as the guests come, he teaches and he preaches them to them unhindered. Unhindered. The church has gone through great opposition. We have gone through great persecution, my friends, but God's word continues to move across the world, both in democracies and in communist countries and in dictatorships. The word of God is being spread unhindered, unhindered. In Acts chapter 1, verse 8, we read these words, "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea and Samaria, and the ends of the earth." When we look at the book of Acts as a whole, we will find that those first 7 chapters, Jesus is at work by the Holy Spirit through the apostles, where? In Jerusalem. And then in chapters 8 through 12, we find that now it begins to spread. Remember Philip, reading about Philip and the Ethiopian. The word begins to spread in Judea and Samaria. And the last 16 chapters of the book of Acts, we read how the word of God now goes to the ends of the earth. So as we continue reading through Acts in these next few weeks, my friends, I invite you to watch for the following features in the books in this book of Acts. The first one is this, and that is the prominence of Jesus Christ. Jesus has gone. He has left his disciples. He is not physically in their presence anymore. But Jesus, my friends, is still very much at work. Second, we find the prominence of the Holy Spirit. We are introduced to the Holy Spirit early on, right away in Acts chapter 1. The Holy Spirit was promised by Jesus many, many times, and the Spirit is here. The Spirit is with you and me right here in this church service today. We are not living in the apostolic age anymore, but we are living in the age of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is moving across the world today. The third thing we see is the prominence of the church. Here we have an account and the story of the birth of the true church. And of course, with that comes the power of the church, and the power of the church comes through the power of the Holy Spirit, and it is at work today, very much so. The next thing we see is the prominence of territory, of places. As I said before, this all begins in Jerusalem. The disciples are there in Jerusalem. They're waiting for the Holy Spirit, and there they are in Jerusalem trying to figure out how things are going to go. But over the course of time, it ends in Rome, with an estimated millions of believers coming to Christ by the end of the first century. The next thing we see is the prominence of people. Did you know the book of Acts mentions 110 people throughout the book of Acts? Individuals are mentioned, and besides that are the crowds. Peter is at the very beginning of Acts. We read about Peter from the very beginning, and Paul is the one who is at the end of the book of Acts. And although the other apostles aren't spoken of quite so much, we do read a little bit about John, and some of the names may pop up here and there. We know that their testimony had a huge impact, even though they may not have been recorded as such. Countless others of people came to know Christ as Lord and Savior because of these people. The gospel spread throughout the Mediterranean area. It's interesting to note, one of the commentaries I read, they said that they believe that Peter and Paul and Luke actually knew one another, maybe even had lunch together once in a while, discussed things together periodically. They all lived roughly the same time. Finally, my friends, we have the prominence of the resurrection. He is risen. That is the central message, because without the resurrection, my friends, the gospel message is dead. Without the resurrection. The resurrection is central to the gospel. It is the heart of the gospel. Peter, on the day of Pentecost, preached the resurrection to the people who were there. Paul would often teach of the resurrection throughout his letters. It is the heart of his message over and over again. And why are we here on Sunday instead of Saturday? Why do we worship the first day of the week instead of the seventh day of the week, which was the tradition of the Jews at that time, which is the tradition of Seventh-day Adventists today? We worship on the first day because Jesus rose from the dead on the first day. And the disciples spread the good news. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Indeed, he is. That, my friends, is so central to the gospel message. We celebrate the resurrection each and every Sunday. I got to thinking, maybe we should start every Sunday service in the salutation by saying, He is risen. He is risen indeed. That's what it's all about. Without the resurrection, our faith is lost. Here are a few highlights that we saw in this week's reading. First of all, we saw and witnessed the ascension of Jesus in Acts chapter 1, verse 7. An important verse for us to remember in Acts 1, verse 7. This is one to hang on to because we're hearing a lot of things about prophecy these days. It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority. Many people have tried to guess the return of Christ. The Millerites tried to do it back, I believe, in the 1800s. They sold everything, went up on a hillside and waited for Christ to come, and he never showed up. Oh, we got the date wrong. Let's try this again. I think it's like 6 months from now. Well, by then, he was losing a lot of his followers. There's no reason for us to speculate, my friends. Yes, things are happening in the Middle East. We just wonder, are we stepping through the threshold of the last days? We are in the last days. We've been in the last days for a long, long time. When Christ is going to appear, we do not know. That is up to the Father and by his authority. The next thing we notice is that Judas, of course, is gone. Matthias has now taken his place through the casting of lots. The Pentecost experience of having the Holy Spirit come, we read about that. And, of course, sermons, Peter's great, great sermon. And we read how 3,000 people came to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ at the end of that incredible sermon. Peter and John are teaching people. They're healing people. And in Acts chapter 2, verse 47, we read that the Lord added daily to the number of believers. Every single day in Jerusalem, people are coming to accept Christ. Of course, these gentlemen are now hauled before the Sanhedrin. They're interrogated. They're questioned. And I like the response. In Acts chapter 4, verse 12, salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name in heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved. Hang on to that, my friends. Underline that in your Bible. If you don't have your Bible, jot it down. It's on page 1406 in your chronological Bible. It's Acts chapter 4, verse 12. This is so important. It is essential for us as Christians. There is no other name under heaven. That includes all the great philosophers, all these great teachers out here, all these people, people that other people are following that claim that they know the road to salvation are false. They're dead ends. And Peter, with all confidence, stands before the Sanhedrin and he tells them that salvation is found in no one else but in Jesus Christ. We went on to read how people began to share their material possessions, and they did so thinking Christ would return at any time. But what a wonderful gesture, and what a wonderful thing for us as Christians to be able to share with one another when people are in need. They continue to heal and to teach. They're brought before the Sanhedrin once again, the ruling body, and what was their response? Oh, woe is us. Let's just go back to fishing. This is getting a little bit tough. They really scolded us. They're threatening to whip us. Let's just give this whole thing up. No. They left rejoicing because they had been counted worthy of suffering disgrace for the name. What name? The name of Jesus. Acts chapter 5, verse 41. Some people claim when you become a Christian, they invite people to come to Christ. And they'll tell you things like, you know, if you just accept Christ as your Lord and Savior, your problems will go away. Pray for health and you'll have health. Pray for wealth and you'll have wealth. Everything will just fall into place. Life will be grand. And all you have to do is name it and claim it because God wants you to have the best of everything. He created the world for his children. Therefore, name it and claim it, and that's yours. You need to be very, very careful with those teachings, my friends. I like what another great evangelist said. When people come to Christ, he tells them, be ready, be prepared. Know the word of God because you will be attacked. Persecution will come to you in one form or another when you claim Christ as your Lord and Savior. Be ready for it. Christianity isn't for the weak of heart. The weak of heart are welcome to come. We want you to come, but now let us build that heart and make you strong and full in the word of God because you will be attacked. It is not the easy way out. These men left rejoicing because they thought, wow, I was worthy to suffer under the name of Jesus Christ. I've shared with you before that there are times I haven't fit in very well with other people. People at work, you know, they go out and do their drinking thing after work and they're going to go here and go there and I don't join in. Or I make comments at break time about the faith, about Christ. And so they kind of keep you at arm's length. There were times when I felt, boy, I'm kind of missing out. You know, they didn't invite me to be on the bowling team. And then I find out later it becomes nothing but a big Yeah, it's a lot of fun, but then, you know, get a little heavy on the booze and the guys chasing the gals, and I'm thankful I'm not there. But there are times when, yes, I would sit alone because I'm a Christian. But that's awesome because Christ is there with me. I'd rather sit alone in a chair and have nobody want to be around me because of my faith rather than having B.O., you know? All right. Next we read, I like this Pharisee, Gamaliel. He tells the other Pharisees in the Sanhedrin, you know, you need to just back off on these guys. Because if what they're doing and what they're preaching is not of God, it's going to just drift away. But if it is of God, you can't stop it. There's no way you're going to stop it. We read of that account. And then, of course, the office of deacon is instituted in Acts chapter 6 and Acts chapter 7. As they are in Jerusalem, this verse is so easy to just gloss over. It's on page 1410 at the very top, verse 7 of Acts chapter 6. The word of God spread. The number of disciples in Jerusalem increased rapidly, and a large number of priests, became obedient to the faith. We often think of the Sanhedrin and the Pharisees and the teachers and the preachers of the law just being, you know, just really out there. But look at here, a large number of the priests become believers in Jesus Christ. How many times don't we just read over that? We really don't give it much weight, but think of this. Lives are being changed. And these priests are going to now change the lives of those who come to the temple. God's church is on the move. God's church is on the move. It was on the move then, and it's on the move today. Well, let's bring it home. I'm going to close with this illustration. Because you and me, my friends, are the church. We are just one little drop in the bucket of the church worldwide. We have brothers and sisters all over the world. They may not look like us, talk like us, use our language. They may worship in different types of buildings. But we are one together in the Lord Jesus Christ. But let's bring it here to Mattawan Community Church. Let's bring it here to our area. There was once a young minister, true story. A young minister went to serve a church in a small town in Oklahoma. The church had been struggling. Attendance had been down. There weren't that many people there. But this young man went with all kinds of optimism. He was going to really change things at this church. He was going to revive it. He had great hope. He was going to turn it around. And he did the best he could week after week after week after week. But very little changed. He came up with one last idea. He put an announcement in the newspaper. This is back in the days when we got our news on a newspaper rather than our electronic devices. He put an announcement that the church had died and that on Sunday afternoon there would be a funeral for the church. Well, that Sunday afternoon, the town came out. The church was absolutely packed like it had never been before. Standing room only, the people came. In front of the church was a casket, a wooden casket. There were flowers adorning the casket. The pastor went through an entire funeral service, and after the eulogy, he took the flowers, brushed them aside, he opened the casket, and he invited the people to come, single file, parade in front of the casket, and take a look at the remains of the church. They paraded by one, and they left with heads bowed, feeling guilty and shamed. Inside the casket was a mirror. My friends, you and I are the church. The building isn't the church. You and I are the church. The book of Acts ends rather abruptly, as it should, because it's still being written today. The acts of the church have not stopped. They continue yet today. So may we all continue in our vital roles of being a church that is in action. Let us pray. Gracious God, we read the accounts of the early church, and We are amazed, Father, at the courage of these men and women to spread the good news in times when they face possible jail time for doing just that. And yet we know that down through the centuries, very little has changed. Your church has faced opposition and persecution. And yet, Father, your word goes forth. Because we, as your believers, want to carry it forth into the world. Father, I ask that you will give each one of us as individuals and as a church, as a whole, as a group, the courage, the ability to move forward, to do our part, to expand your kingdom here on earth until that wonderful and glorious day when you return. Father, we are thankful for this congregation, a place we call our church. We are thankful for the many missions and ministries we are able to support. We are thankful that we have the means to do that. May we not grow weary in doing good works. May we continue on. May we do well. May we fight the good fight together to bring the good news of Christ to those who have yet to hear the good news. Father, I ask that you will bless us as individual families and individuals. Watch over us as we journey through our weeks. Bless the children at home, at school. Bless us at work and at play. Give us opportunities to share Christ. Give us the words to say, as sometimes they're kind of hard to speak. Maybe we find ways to simplify the gospel. Maybe just letting someone know that God loves them. We thank you, Father. May your church continue on in strength and courage, and with success of bringing lost souls to Christ until that wonderful day you come. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. At this time, our gifts and offerings will be received. Please take a moment, fill out the attendance pad, and pass it to the neighbor sitting next to you. Thank you, Jessica, for that wonderful Thanksgiving season hymn that you just played. A little off. That's a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful time of year. Well, let's stand together and sing the How Firm a Foundation. We'll sing verses 1, 2, and 4. Receive the benediction, and then we will sing Blessed Be the Tie That Binds. 1, 2, and 4 of 275.
Thank you.
my friends, to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Amen.